I want to supersize your impact. And the best way that I know how to do that is to point you to Jesus. Kenneth Scott Latterett, the former president of the American Historic Society, said this: "As the centuries pass by, the evidence is accumulating that, measured by its effect on history, Jesus is the most influential life ever lived on this planet. The influence appears to be mounting. No other life lived on this planet has so widely and deeply affected mankind." In the first chapter of Mark, we get glimpses into why Jesus' life was so influential, why he had such a supersized impact. And the first is this: because he knew his self-worth. Look at verse 11. It says this: "A voice came from heaven, 'You are my son, whom I love, and with whom I am well pleased.'" Jesus had just been baptized by John in the River Jordan. And then God has this voice comes from heaven, and God says, "You are my son." God like gives him his identity, his self-worth. You have value. When you learn your value in God and that you are a child of God in whom God is well pleased, when you start to really get that in your heart, when you have self-worth, you are on your way to being able to make the impact that you want to make. The second thing is this: that Jesus understood his message. He had a message. Verse 14 says, "Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. 'The time has come,' he said. 'The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news.'" I had the privilege of meeting Dallas Willard. He's a well-known and well-loved Christian author and speaker. And in our dialogue, he said something that really stood out to me. He said, "Drew, don't pray for opportunities to speak. Pray for something to say." And that really stood out to me. Pray for something to say. If you want to impact, you need to know the message that God has given you. What is it that you want to bring? For me, I have a desire to see disciples made who will make other disciples. That's why I do all of this vlogging and blogging and all the things that I do with my website and Facebook. It's an extension of my heart to make disciples who will make disciples. And I believe one of those is you. I want to impact your life. And I know my message, my call is that God has called you to be a disciple who will make disciples. What's your call? What's your message? What's your words that God's given you? The way that you can kind of determine that is by considering what your passions are and maybe what your values are, and then further on, what your dreams are. What's your passions? What's your values? What's your dreams? For me, my passion is to see lives change, for that light bulb to glow on whenever people see that, hey, God is real and he has a plan for my life. My values is discipleship, in that we have to learn to multiply ourselves and give ourselves to others for God's love and kingdom to spread and advance. And then my dream is that this would go way beyond me into my children and to those that I know and into your life, and it would spread. And just by me being faithful with what I have, I might be able to see the whole world influenced and impacted. I want to supersize my impact by having a message that God has given me. The third way you can supersize your impact is to have an active relationship with God. Verse 35 says, "Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed." Jesus himself did not rely on his own abilities. He was constantly in communication with God, spending time with him, listening to him. Sometimes when things start to go well for us, we forget about God and we press on thinking somehow it's our own abilities. If you will keep an active relationship with God, you'll have an impact. And then notice, whenever the pressure comes on Jesus, Jesus is calmly, he just says, "Look, this is why I've come. This is where I need to go." He knows what he's supposed to do. He knows the impact that he's meant to make because he's had time with God. The last thing I want to tell you is that if you will have compassion for people, you'll have a supersized impact. Verse 40, "A man with leprosy came to Jesus and begged him on his knees, 'If you are willing, you can make me clean.'" Jesus was indignant. He reached out his hand and touched the man. "I am willing," he said. "Be clean." Jesus had incredible compassion, and that compassion is what compels us and what enables us to have the supersize impact. As I leave these thoughts with you, I want to show you a clip from Pastor Tony Evans, one of the men that I really respect. Watch this clip.
There is a direct correlation between ministry and love for God and ministry and love for others. And by others, I mean folks with a need who can't help you back and for which you do not expect help back. And the more God sees you do this, the more blessed the sun will be on you. We all have to be reminded of this and made conscious of this. I'm made conscious of it every Sunday morning because in our first service, every Sunday, there's a young man. He sits over here. And in the first service every Sunday, at the beginning of service, he walks over to me. He cannot hear, he cannot speak. He never misses church. He walks over to me, he grabs my hand, and he does this. What he's saying is, look at my suit. He's saying, look at my suit. And what he's asking is, do I look okay? And every week I go. And once he sees that, yeah. You know what he wants to know? Am I okay? He's just looking for an okay. He's not asking for money. He's not asking for time. Am I just okay? Do I look? I can't hear. I can't talk, but am I okay? Can I get somebody to say, I'm okay? Pastor, are you too big to tell me I'm okay? In a few hours, I'll be driving down with many of you to Waco. At the appointed time, I will stand before what is expected to be 35,000 people live, not counting the people on television, to preach the Word of God. When God looks down at that stadium today and sees Tony Evans preaching, he will not credit me with greatness. Now some folks may, oh, you spoke to 35,000 people. He will not be impressed. God the Father is not going to turn to God the Son, and God the Son is not going to turn to the Holy Spirit. You see that evidence down there? 35,000 people, not counting folk watching on TV. He's a bad boy. I ain't going to get no credit for that. When he sees me touch that deaf boy, I'm going to get credit for that one. I'm going to get credit for caring for somebody who can't do anything in return. May God keep me and keep us from becoming celebrities. Do what we've been called to do. Do it to the best of our ability. But let's not be a celebrity church. I want God to feel comfortable to come in here on Sunday. I don't want him to say, well, they having church, but I'm not going because there ain't nothing but a bunch of celebs in that place. Who knows who and who can cut a deal with who and who's popular and who can sit up front and who has to sit in the back. This is not that kind of place.